Have you ever kept a diary of how you spend your time? Well, if not, the Australian Bureau of Statistics has. They have released their time use study, which measures the daily activities of 2,000 diverse households. And of those aged 15 years and over in those households, had them keep a diary over 2 days and account for all of their time. It's a pretty fascinating study and reveals a lot about how people are spending time on work, domestic duties, recreation, and even sleep. It also explored how rushed or pressed for time people feel. So in today's episode, we're going to unpack what this time use study reveals about how we spend one of the most precious things we have, which is our time. And joining me to discuss this today is social researcher and futurist Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back onto the podcast.
Thanks, Ashley. Great to be with you.
It's always good to have you on and to discuss heavy research topics. This one's like everything is interesting to us, but this one's quite fascinating, and also probably because it's a rare study that the ABS doesn't conduct very often. Is that right?
It's quite rare, and we have to hang out a while for this one. In fact, the last one was 15 years ago. So, you know, we get excited when the census data comes out every 5 years. This one, triple excitement, because it's rare indeed to get such data shared. And I guess we might think, well, why does it matter how people are spending their time? It's their own private sort of time diary. What's that got to do with anything? But I like what Carl Rogers, the American psychiatrist, said, that what's most personal is most universal. And so the personal habits of people and how individuals spend their time is actually so relatable and tells us something of ourselves. And so to have this study of 2,000 households across our nation to be able to compare how they spend time to how we spend it and how it's changed over time is a fascinating study indeed.
Absolutely. Mark, what stood out to you from this study? What did you find most interesting? I mean, we were discussing offline just earlier that there is a lot in it. What stood out to you, and what did you find most fascinating about how much time people in Australia are spending on different activities in their life?
Well, firstly, that we're still working very hard, that the average Australian is working just under 8 hours per day. In fact, the census data, which was conducted around the same time nationally, shows that 38% of employed people are working more than 8 hours per day. So that's pretty solid work is taking place. The other aspect of the big use of time is sleep. And on the positive side, we are getting our 8 hours of sleep. In fact, this study showed on average just a little bit over 8 hours, men getting more sleep than women. But we're getting solid amounts of sleep. So I found that good for the health of the nation. And on the recreation side, I found it interesting that we're getting about 5 hours or so recreation time, non-discretionary time in our days. Not quite like the 8 hours that was recommended in the old 8-8-8, you know, 8 hours work, 8 hours sleep, 8 hours play. Some are doing more than the 8 hours work. We're on track with the sleep. The play is a bit below that. And that's because there's a lot of other tasks going on, particularly domestic work, you know, unpaid work around the place, child care and child rearing roles that aren't included in that 8-8-8. Mantra of old.
Yeah, it's a really interesting one, and a quite an interesting thing, I think, to reflect on in your own life. Like, how much does your own time use align with that sort of idealistic, so to speak, split of 8 hours work, 8 hours sleep, and 8 hours recreation? I guess we should also maybe take into the consideration the fact that this study was conducted in November 2020 and into July, into July 2021. So over a period, they had people collecting this data. And I guess that was a time as well where maybe there was a higher proportion of us working from home, or that probably played into this as well in terms of the context, do you think?
Yeah, it did. And that's why it can't directly be compared to the prior ones, because it was a particular time in our history. But some of the habits are longer term trends. Not everything was impacted by COVID, but certainly a delay in or a reduction in commute time was fascinating. And we even know from the census data that 21% of Australians, employed Australians, were working from home during this period. Prior, it had been very small single digits, 3 or 4%. So So that definitely was a different period. However, a lot of those trends may well continue on. In fact, working from home is continuing on, and some of the activities that this picked up as well are people engaging more in some at-home recreational activities, the cocooning, if you like, of nearly 3 hours a day of screen time is different to what we might have seen pre-COVID and may indeed see ongoing, less of the going out, more of the at-home time.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of those sort of parts of that sort of 888 is a big part, which is work. We've written a lot about the importance of work in our life. Mark, what does this study tell us about, I mean, maybe this is a slightly controversial question, but like, does it give us a definitive answer on who's working harder, men or women? Now, that's a loaded question because we've got different types of work, like paid and unpaid, but even that yielded some fascinating results. But what's your perspective on what this study tells us about, yeah, men and women and the difference with regards to sort of working in their days?
Well, if we look at division of labor across this by men and women, we've still got some traditional role delineations taking place. So men are engaged in more paid work per week, about an hour more per day. So 8 hours and 13 minutes on average for men, 7 hours and 12 minutes on average for women of those who are working in paid work. But then if we add in the domestic work, so just work around the home, work in any unpaid capacity in our day, we've got women working more than an hour on top of men per day. So men are doing about 3 hours or so, women doing almost 4.5 hours of unpaid work in a day. And that's a mix of things, so domestic chores, food preparation, shopping. In fact, in every category of domestic work, almost every category, women were doing more. I mean, even things like pet care and shopping and all of the cleaning and certainly in almost, in fact, in every category of child rearing work, from the dressing of children and food preparation for children through to the nurturing and the reading and the talking with and spending time with them, the women outdoing the men. And that's why more than an hour extra of both the child rearing and the domestic work was conducted by women compared to men, except for yard maintenance and car maintenance, where the men picked up and just outshone the women. But that was a small part of the day in terms of time spent. And so if we add up all of the work, whether it's paid or unpaid, we have women working longer hours than men. And if we look at the other side of the equation, who's got more leisure time or the uncommitted time, the recreational time, men have half an hour extra free time compared to women. So that tells us there something about how it's playing out. Yes, men might be spending longer in paid work, but if you include the domestic and the childcare side of it, that's where the women are spending longer in total work than males in Australia.
Yeah, I remember we wrote a little bit about this in many different, I think, reports over the years, but also in the Work Wellbeing book, just around how people are using their time and dividing that time. And I remember even when we wrote that a few years ago, we had some commentary in there around like the labour gap, I guess, is closing in terms of more women participating in the workforce due to a number of reasons, affordability, but also changing gender roles and those sorts of things. But then the domestic gap wasn't closing. And I guess this is a great study, I think, because it really paints that picture well. And I guess anecdotally, we just, again, I shared at the beginning, like not many people are recording every minute they spend of their time unless maybe they've been encouraged to or helping out, you know, with this sort of study. But it does give some data to the fact that there is a whole bunch of hidden work that's unpaid that particularly, I guess, this study shows women are doing. So if women are feeling incredibly busy and we use that as sort of anecdotal in our conversations, we've got the data to back that up here. So,
well, there is the data there, exactly. And these are households choosing how they divide their time. So it's not to think that there's some deficiency in Australian households. If men are doing more paid work and women are doing more unpaid work, people work out their roles and in their relationships and amidst the children or the childcare or the other responsibilities. And so that is what it is, and families are making those choices, and that's all fine. But it certainly does show that women are doing a lot of the work here, have slightly less recreation, slightly less sleep, and slightly more of the burden of the family and the domestic responsibility. So that certainly should be something that we're all aware of. But there is probably one figure that highlights that maybe all is not completely well here with this division of labour, and that is that if we look at the Australian age group that says they are often or always rushed or pressed for time to the highest degree, it's 35 to 44 year olds. They are the busiest people in Australia, because it's in that age group where people have not only the paid work and of course the bills, the cost of living at their peak. If they've got children, that's the age that they've got them, and really raising those kids through the expensive time of all that's required in modern families, with education and extra costs that come there, and running the kids around and social and co-curricular activities. There's a lot going on. And then, of course, there's the house and the mortgage and the yard and everything else that is just in the busyness of the middle parenting years. But if we divide further beyond age and look at males versus females in that 35 to 44-year-old, we have women, 35 to 44, from this study, are the busiest in Australia, because 55% of them said that they are often or always rushed or pressed for time, more than half, which is way above the national data, where it's about a third of Australians say they're often or always rushed or pressed for time. So if you've got half of the women in this busy stage of life saying that they're rushed and pressed for time, often or always, that's significant, and that's the stress zone, is the point of that question. And so it's certainly an age group and a proportion of that age group that needs the support and needs us to recognise the business of that life stage. Now, part of it is a life stage, and that's just what happens when you choose to have kids and you choose to raise them. It hits the heavy burden times, and there's an easier period that is, we know from the data, to come as they move certainly through the 50s. But they're right in the peak of it at that period of time, and we ought to notice it and be well aware of it.
Yeah, I was reflecting when you were sharing, just, I guess I'm interested to see where this plays out in the future, even for, you know, younger generations today. I mean, if I think about my own life and my experience so far with my husband in division of labor, and we're both working full time, I feel like we carry things pretty 50-50. Now, maybe we should do a time study and track all our time and actually see if that's the case. But again, I was thinking, you know, we don't have kids yet. We're the dink life stage, double income, no kids, not yet in that 35 to 44 year old bracket, but I can empathize with those who I do know who are in that life stage, because like you mentioned, Mark, there's so many more commitments. And another part of this that I was thinking about was a study that we conducted for our development company a few years ago about how much people save time when they live in an apartment compared to a house, even just way less maintenance. And I'm living proof of that. Like, we lived in a house with a backyard, and there was, I think, living out the stats, like 3 hours a week on yard maintenance. We don't have that anymore, so that's built into extra recreation time for us, and a smaller place to clean. So it's interesting, even just a few different factors that can sort of impact that. So it's good to know that we should be wary of those in that life stage, just maybe giving them a bit of a helping hand when people are busy. And 55%, like more than half, that's a high amount, like you said, compared to the national average of a third. Like, that's not great that half the time where women in this life stage are feeling rushed or pressed for time. So,
and it is often the life stage where, because they've got the kids, they've also got the detached home, which is going to come with the front yard and the backyard and extra rooms that all need cleaning, and social activities where friends are coming and the friends of their kids are coming. So keeping house clean is extra challenging. There's a bit more of the social side of their life and preparation for those activities, which is where you come up with this figure in this study of more than 4 hours on domestic activities or time spent domestically per day. You know, that includes everything there, but that's a lot of time that people are spending on the domestic chores. And it is because we are 3/4 of households live in detached homes, and that definitely, as you said, adds to the time issue. One area where we have seen time spent decline is in food preparation. So less than an hour, the average Australian who is preparing food is spending per day on that preparation across all the meals in total. So that just does highlight the fact that life has become a bit more convenient with some prepackaged foods, with pre-prepared ingredients, with the equipment our kitchens are decked out with now just to make that food prep a lot quicker. And so that has saved time. I found it fascinating actually to see that we spend longer consuming our food today, about an hour and 15 minutes in total per person, than preparing the food, which is, as I said, just under the 1 hour mark. Now, this is unique in history because normally the food preparation time was a lot longer than the time that we spent sitting down eating that food. But we've now flipped it. And so it's actually the consumption of the food over a day that takes the longer time, which is a fantastic thing that we can sit with others, we can interact, we can spend an hour and 20 minutes a day eating food and interacting as we do, and the food prep has been contained. There's nothing virtuous about necessarily just spending more and more time preparing food. And if we can use equipment and technology and support to make that more amenable in the busy times of life, then that's fantastic. As long as we still have the healthy options and it's still cost effective to get those food support, then that's great. But what we haven't been able to reduce very much is all of the domestic chores. And even though we've got the equipment that'll make cleaning a bit easier, we've got better automations in that, it's a push button on the dishwasher and the washing machine, perhaps even a dryer, maybe a robo-vac doing the rounds now. Even though we have all of that, Australians are still spending time, and that's because domestic chores are not something we totally want to excise from our life, just as we wouldn't want to reduce further and further the time in childcare. This is the stuff of life. As we said, a time use study is really our life played out on a daily basis, and people want to tidy a home, and there's a satisfaction in cleaning something up. There's a delight in preparing something and presenting that. There's great virtue in raising those children, spending time with them. So this idea that technology is going to reduce domestic chores and increase our leisure time is not necessarily the goal that a lot of people have in the reality of life. And so this idea that that we will reduce this further, I don't think is realistic. It's the stuff of life, and people enjoy serving the family and each other in some of these tasks.
Yeah, absolutely. It reminds me actually of a friend of mine who I was growing up with and their family, and we would go over for dinner sometimes, like with a group of friends, and we'd have dinner with them. And then they had a dishwasher there, but they were like, we were like, go to pack the dishwasher. Like, oh, we actually don't use the dishwasher. I was like, what do you mean you don't use the dishwasher? And they're like, oh no, this is like family time for us to like wash the dishes and stuff. And I was like, what? And so but we actually had like fun time just chatting, I guess, rather than stacking the dishwasher and then going off and all watching TV and not really having chats. And it's almost like I've heard it say, sometimes you have like more deep and meaningful chats when you're actually occupied doing something, like when you're driving a car, when you're washing dishes or something, rather than like even sitting across from someone. And so, yeah, it was interesting to hear that. I mean, I don't know, hopefully, if they've got a lot of people coming over there that crack the dishwasher out. But yeah, it's interesting how those things have changed over time. And something else that I just mentioned there, even around like screens, this study also went into in terms of free time and recreation. I mean, there's so many different categories here around what people do with their free time. Was there anything, Mark, that stood out to you that was interesting in terms of how people were spending that recreational time in their life?
Just that we spend almost as long in the unpaid domestic work as we do in the recreation. I think that's something that's great. You know, we're not just living to do nothing. we're living life and spending that, as you said, you know, washing dishes together. You know, a lot of people don't put the clothes dryer on because they actually want to hang it outside. Firstly, because it's going to save electricity, it's a good environmental option. And there's something about encouraging children to do chores. There's something about serving each other in these ways. So the goal of life, at least from this study, is highlighting that it's not just about minimizing work and maximizing recreation. And that's why, you know, talk of, you know, 4-day working week or a 3-day or perhaps increased leisure time. Maybe we can get rid of work from our life entirely. I think misses the point of life and the benefits that come socially from this interaction. So on the screen time use, it was fascinating to see that the average Australian spends 2 hours and 55 minutes watching TV or video per day, which is unchanged from 40 years ago. In the 80s, it was the same. So it's not as though we're spending longer and longer on screens. I found it interesting that only a third of Australians go to the internet every day. And so it's not the absolute staple for everyone from a recreation perspective. Now, most people might be in their work using the internet, and for downtime, they're not always going there. But after TV time, internet use was the next biggest, followed by exercise. But again, only a third of people said that they exercise or engage in outdoor activities on a daily basis. Next down the list was reading, and maybe astonishing for people to realize, but only one in five Australians spends time reading each day. Video games was only about 10% of Australians, particularly younger people, and far more likely to be males than females. And then by the time we get to activities like listening to music for recreation, not just as background while we do a chore, but for recreation, only about one in 20, the same number that that will engage in hobbies or activities. One in 20 Australians or play puzzles or games together, about one in 20 Australians. So it's interesting just to look at some of those traditional pursuits and how the board games activity or the hobby is not actually the mainstream in Australia. It's still engaged in on a daily basis by, you know, 5%. But it's a single digit percentage there. In fact, it's the same proportion that engage in religious activities on a daily basis, about 5% of Australians, and that's for about an hour a day for those who do. So, you know, unique study this one to find out how are people out there spending their time, how many are doing it, and how long are they spending on those particular activities. I did find all of that quite fascinating.
Yeah, and interesting to see even television still really kind of dominate that area, even above the internet use. Like, I guess I was kind of surprised, but I think about my own time use, and I guess the TV is still sort of, like, I've heard it be likened to the digital fireplace, you know, and it's I think, good to see that. Sometimes I think a lot of maybe parents of Gen Alpha are a bit worried with the individual screen use or the individual internet use because it's harder to monitor and see. But even TV, which can be pretty passive sort of consumption, is still something that people are engaging with, even with the individual devices on the rise. But interesting there to see all the different ways that people are spending their time. And even I imagine the exercise and even walking pets. And I've heard that those things even can be really great to, you know, bring families together. I've heard some people say that pets like revolutionize their family time because they're not just sitting watching TV. They're actually out in the park spending time together. And maybe even during this time with the pandemic, I remember those days, which will be a distant memory soon enough, where everybody was in the park because we were all in lockdown and that was all you could do. So,
well, and on the pets, this was fascinating. You know, how long does the average family who has a pet spend with their pets each day in terms of directly interacting with them, walking them, feeding them, or just spending some time patting them, etc.? And 45 minutes is the answer, which was higher than I would have thought. No longer is Spot or Rex just the dog out the back and sort of watches the family through the window. We're talking a 3/4 of an hour per day of the interaction. Now, encouragingly, those who have not the furry babies, but the real ones are spending four times as long in caring for their children and interacting with them. But the pets do get a look in, which is good to see. And probably in lockdown, they've had the good life with even more time with the owners than was the case pre-COVID.
Yeah, probably both pets and pet owners experiencing a bit of separation anxiety after all those months, you know, together full time and then maybe back to the office or back to commuting, changing that. Another area of this study that was quite fascinating was looking at volunteering. And we've done and conducted here at McCrindle, as you would know, obviously, Mark, a few sort of reports annually about not-for-profits and the state of volunteering and the trends there. What was interesting to you, Mark, in terms of how long people are spending volunteering? And again, the context being within, I guess, a COVID year, so to speak, 2020, 2021. But did that align with some of the trends that we've noticed in our studies about how long people are volunteering or where the volunteering trends are going among particularly, I guess, like the emerging generations?
Well, it reinforced a trend in the COVID period of far less volunteering. Now, whether we've just hit a new low and it'll bounce back as we get back into life as normal, or whether, you know, it's going to take a while to rebuild is not yet known, but it was way down. So prior to the pandemic, about 1 in 5 Australians volunteered on a regular basis. We got down to 14% in the 2021 census. This study, if we just look at, okay, did you spend time in the last 2 days volunteering? Just 2.7% of people did. Now, the census data at 14%, that's those who have a volunteer role. They might only volunteer once a quarter or twice a year, but 14% are volunteers. This looks at, did you do it in the last 2 days, you know, over this time study, and only 2.7% of people did, which seems extremely low. But, you know, it is those that really, that is a part of their daily activity. It's a part of their week, and they're actively engaged. And they are engaged because it was about 2 hours per day for those that were volunteering, but a very low rate and lower than we've seen in the past. So I think all those in charities and community organisations are feeling it. How can we re-engage with our volunteers? How can we rebuild that? How can we connect with them? Because we know from our studies, as we've done a lot into the not-for-profit sector, that volunteering is a key part of community. You don't have to volunteer to be part of a community, but by volunteering, it builds that community and it builds your belonging into that community. It does a great thing for not just the neighbour, but for one's own heart. And it's a key part of the social interaction that we experience. So we'll be a better community and individuals will be better off if we can see that rebuild. And it certainly does need rebuilding from what we saw prior years.
Absolutely. I'm really fascinated to watch this space. I guess in general, just because, like you mentioned, this study was conducted in a bit of an anomaly in a COVID time, but particularly, I guess, with volunteering and not-for-profits and charities. I mean, I was just speaking to one as part of my role here over the weekend, and they were just sharing that they're really struggling to engage the younger generations in that regular volunteering, whereas older generations, I guess, tended to buy in and commit continually versus younger generations just kind of not committing, but maybe doing a couple of hours here or a bit there, which can be hard to run have consistency for not only, I guess, the organization, but those who are benefiting from those volunteers and whatever that looks like. So yeah, like you mentioned, Mark, it's not just a benefit to the neighbor or to those who are benefiting, but also to the volunteers themselves. So it'd be interesting to see whether this bounces back or it's a pendulum swing or how we do engage or whether it's just a life stage thing that young people are like, oh, I just want to keep my options open, but maybe as they get older, they form a connection to a cause or a charity and then they commit regularly. I don't know. It'd be interesting to see where it all goes.
Yeah, it's so important. And the more that we can see that flourish, the better. And it's also engaging, regardless of volunteering, also community interactions. And this one was a little on the low side as well. Those that engage with neighbours or in their communities in an active sense, just from a social perspective. Again, partly the COVID factor of people not getting out their front doors as much, but it's key and it's always been the hallmarks of the Australian community in the suburbs as the chat over the fence, the interaction with the neighbours, knowing who's up the road and always being up for a bit of a lend of the mower or a helping hand as needed. And that's the lifeblood of community. We need to see that be rebuilt.
Yeah, absolutely. And I imagine a lot of people would have been, and we've seen it in other studies, like incredibly lonely at this time as well without some of these opportunities to connect with those in their community, whether it is their neighbours. Maybe they could do that from a distance if people had to distance during this study and this time. So, yeah, it'd be a weird kind of point in history to look back on and go, remember those times that we weren't allowed to, like, we were just forbidden to go to the office and work with our colleagues. We were forbidden to do these things. It was highly discouraged, and you would get in trouble if you were doing that, which we know is so key to our sense of belonging and community, even for people going to church, all those things that are just key to our identity we weren't able to do. So, yeah, an interesting time to live in. But that's kind of looking back. If we look to the future, Mark, I'd be really keen to see where you think this will go in terms of some of these ways we use our time. You kind of alluded to it, I guess, in a couple of your answers there, which is quite an interesting perspective, because I think just if we think about it as a really simple way, it's like, oh, it's a great thing that we're getting more economic with our time, and some of those tasks that we do, like mowing the lawn, can be outsourced. But it's not always that black and white. Like you mentioned, there's some things that we do that maybe seem a bit mundane, but actually give us time for reflection, or get us to work with our hands, or to have an out sort of source or output for some of those things. Where do you think all this is going? Do you think we'll continue to get more efficiencies and more, or do you reckon we'll maybe swing back and see the value of these things? What do you think where it's all going?
Well, I think that some things won't change because they're just integral to the human experience, and making contributions through work and particularly employment is one of those. There's always talk, and there has been a history of reducing those working hours per week. But you know, here we are pretty consistently between 7 and 8 hours per day. And what's interesting is that if we look at the paid work as well as work-related activities, you know, the travel to work, the time spent preparing for work, etc., it hasn't changed, even though we've now got less time on the commute because a lot more people are working from home, or at least work from home a few days a week, and perhaps even less time preparing for work because we don't have to put on the full suit or dress it up. It's a lot more casual. Yet we're still finding that the people are spending in work-related and work activities about the same time. So they've just taken the time that they were saving and put it into work. And that tells me that Australians are enjoying their work. They get benefit from that work. They get social interaction. They grow through it. There's a sense of contribution through that work, a sense of meaning and purpose and fulfillment, and even something of our own self-identity. So this idea that work is an impediment, we can just hopefully get it to less and less of an impediment in our life. It's the thing that gets in the way of life. I don't see in this data, I don't see much change to the commitment we give it in terms of time. And I don't see that changing into the future. Yeah, it might move. At the moment, it's between the 7 and 8. It might move to the 6 to 7 hours per day. But certainly it's there as a core part of our life experience. A second thing that probably is not going to change massively is the unpaid work, because whether it's raising kids or whether it's keeping house and making the yard look good, doing those weekend projects outdoors, repainting this or fixing that, redecorating or renovating, you know, Aussies love that, and there's a sense of pride in that, and the home is the castle, as is often said in Australia, and people enjoy those weekend projects, or nowadays in work from home maybe it's become a Friday project instead of the Saturday one, and people enjoy that. So I don't expect that the unpaid work to continue to drop, because there's a sense of pride and purpose in that as well. Hopefully we can see the stress levels drop, the being rushed and pressed for time proportions decline. We can get some balance there. Great to see that the balance around sleep is there, and people keeping healthy in that regard. But probably a big change to the future is just the structures of our week and the structures of our time use. So in the past we had 5 days that were the work days and 2 days that were the more flexible weekend days, and tasks were allocated across those two categories depending on the sort of task it was, i.e., you know, going to a workplace and commuting versus, you know, weekend activities. That's changing, far more blurring, and we're seeing it on the roads. We're seeing sometimes the busy peak hours are now on weekends, not weekdays. We're seeing Mondays and Fridays, far less people in our cities and commuting, as people cram the in-office days to the middle part of the week. We're seeing massive changes in structure to our week, and therefore to our activities and how we spend our time. It's not therefore going to be these daily activities. Maybe people will do exercise, but maybe on the work from home days rather than every day. People won't have a daily 9-to-5 routine because their week is sort of three categories. There's the work from home part of it, there's the work in the office part of it, and there's the weekend part of it. And so massive transformations to therefore every activity, whether the kids are home or in childcare or with grandparents, whether we are doing unpaid or paid work, when and how we're doing the errands and just other activities of life, going up, doing shopping or different things. It's all changing from out of hours or structured times to a new category, a new restructure in our week. And that's all come about since the pandemic because of the work from home phenomena, which is here to stay, which has therefore changed where we work and therefore where we need to live and therefore how our weeks look, how those 7 days are demarcated and how the division of labor across the couples and families has changed. So massive shifts there. I think we're still going to see some of that settle in place, but certainly the world looking forward in terms of how we structure our week is quite different to what we have when we look back.
Yeah, and we've chatted a little bit, and you've mentioned there as well, Mark, just the pandemic and that it threw kind of everything up into the air, and now we've got an opportunity to, yeah, be a bit more intentional and structure it and repurpose some of those ways we spend our time, which, as I think both of us have mentioned in this podcast today, isn't it? It's a special thing we have in life, our time, and it is helpful actually, I think, even this study, just to maybe it's prompt our listeners to think about their own time use and how it's structured and how their week is divided by those things in a simplistic way, like sleep, recreation and work, but then all those other nuances and categories that fit into that. So really fascinating insight today into sort of that social research perspective on how we spend our time, what we prioritize. Thank you so much, Mark, for coming on and helping us dissect this latest release on the ABS today.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Ash.
And if people would like to stay up to date with our analysis of the ABS and their latest insights or our own internally conducted or commissioned research, they can subscribe to the podcast, they can follow us on social media, or they can head to McCrindle.com where we have a lot of articles sort of explaining a lot of these things. So if you've tuned into today's episode, we'd like to thank you for listening and say bye for now.